So good afternoon, everyone. This is the luncheon symposium by Indochina Healthcare. This topic is the hemodynamic management in Cesarean section. May I introduce the moderator, Assistant Professor Namthip Triyasunan from Department of Anesthesiology, Faculty of Medicine, Siriraj Hospital, Mahidol University. Please welcome Associate Professor Namthip.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today, I'm so pleased to be with you in this session to have the honor to introduce our guest speaker. He is a professor of anesthesia and the chairman of Department of Anesthesiology, University Hospital, Leuven, Belgium. He has given over 400 invited lectures at the national and international level. For scientific society works, he has been the chair of Educational Committee of European Society of Regional Anesthesia and Pain Therapy, or ESRA. He is also the chair of Prospect Working Group. His primary clinical interests focus on obstetric anesthesia and anesthesia for cardiovascular disease. He is editor-in-chief in Best Research and Practice in Clinical Anesthesiology and associate editor in European Journal of Anesthesiology and also be executive editor Regional Anesthesia and Pain Medicine. He has published over 200 articles. His current research focuses on obstetric anesthesia. It is a great pleasure to welcome you to join the session, Hemodynamic Management During C-Section, Using Phenylephrine Wisely in Daily Practice. Please welcome Professor Mark Van de Velde.
Very much for the kind introduction and also the kind invitation to speak at this wonderful conference here in Bangkok. Actually, it's my first time in Thailand, thank you again for the invitation. As the introduction was said, I'm going to talk to you on the hemodynamic management for cesarean section patients. I would like to introduce you to what I think is the gold standard for cesarean section, and it is the gold standard for many years in my institution. That's the use of phenylephrine to prevent and treat hypotension in daily clinical practice in these patients. I have to say I have conflicts of interests, of course, because I have given lectures on these topics before. So let's go briefly on what are the complications of hypotension, not only in obstetric patients, but in general populations. If you allow patients to become hypotensive, it will damage the patient, especially if the hypotensive episode is prolonged and is severe. It will increase your risk of myocardial ischemia. It will increase your mortality. It will increase acute kidney injury. You see a lot of problems occurring. And I don't expect you to read this, but this basically says that the more severe the hypotension and the longer it takes, the more red the graph becomes, so the higher the mortality, the higher the complication rate. The severity of hypotension, this is in the general population and general surgical patients, is important. And this is another example that if you manage blood pressure quite well and you go for good treatment of blood pressure, you will have better outcome. And you will see severe adverse events to be reduced, almost halved, in the individualized treatment group where you really target hypotension. The problem with hypotension is this, the definition. This is in C-section patients, and I will show you this slide again later on. There are hundreds of definitions of what is hypotension. But if you look in the literature, especially for cesarean section, it's usually healthy patients. And what about the sick patients, the patients with comorbidity? And in C-section patients, you focus on systolic blood pressure, but is that the right thing to do? Shouldn't you look at diastolic or mean blood pressures? So, and of course, if your definition is different, the incidence of hypotension will also be different. Depending on the studies you look at, it will be in between 7 and 75%. And this is depending on the definition, of course. Phenylephrine is, I have heard, a relatively new drug for you to use. It is an alpha agonist, it will have these properties. So it's more a vasopressor than it's an inotrope, and it will activate vascular alpha-1 receptors. It is more that and has less positive inotropic effects. And this is from a publication, an international consensus statement, and I will come to that in a moment again, where we discuss the use of vasopressors and inotropes in pregnant patients. And as you can see, phenylephrine is a direct alpha-1 agonist with a very rapid onset, its effect is relatively long lasting. It's not really long lasting, but it has a intermediate duration of action, as opposed to, if I'm informed correctly, ephedrine, which is currently being used especially in cesarean section patients as your primary vasopressor to manage hypotension, which is a beta receptor agonist. It has a indirect effect, and that's the most important reason why it's so important to use a drug that is immediately acting, is it has a relatively slow onset after you have given it, although the duration might be prolonged. But what is key in cesarean section is that you only have about 10 to 15 minutes where you start your spinal anesthetic and your baby is born. And it is important for the baby to avoid hypotension during those first 15 minutes. So it has to work quickly, and afterwards, it's not that important anymore. You can administer phenylephrine either via a central line or via a peripheral intravenous line. You can give it as a bolus, or you could give it as an infusion, anywhere between 10 to 100 micrograms per minute. Now let's look at this situation of spinal hypotension during cesarean section. We all know that pregnancy influences the cardiovascular system significantly. You have an increased cardiac output, you have a slightly decreased blood pressure from the non-pregnant state, your systemic vascular resistance is decreased, and your plasma volume is increased. Myocardial contractility is normal, but in some patients might even be increased. And your heart undergoes significant changes. There is hypertrophy of the left ventricle, you hear additional sounds, there is a left axis in the third trimester, and you might see a little bit tachycardia and sometimes premature ventricular contractions. But this is the blood pressure in a pregnant patient. It goes down, and it will go up again by the end of pregnancy, but normally, unless your patient is preeclamptic, it will remain below or at the level the patient had before pregnancy. And the heart rate goes up, as I have mentioned. Myocardial contractility is normal or slightly increased. And of course, we all know the problem of aortocaval compression, that your pregnant uterus will compress the aorta and the vena cava, impeding venous return and causing hypotension and reduced uteroplacental perfusion. And despite the fact that we all think it's only relevant in the third trimester, it actually already starts to have an effect from 14 weeks pregnancy, as has been shown in studies that are more than 70 years old now. So it actually is more important than some might consider. Okay, coming back to this definition of hypotension in cesarean section patients, and you see the list there. What is the definition? Well, in our consensus statement, and depending on that definition, as I said, there is a difference in the incidence of hypotension. But whatever you say, if you give a spinal anesthetic, the majority of your pregnant patients will have hypotension. If you don't do anything, if you would try to prevent it or you manage it by doing something, you might avoid it or reduce the incidence and the severity. But if you wouldn't do anything, you would just give your spinal, you would see hypotension in the majority of patients. In this international consensus statement published 2 years ago, a year and a half ago in Anesthesia, a group of international so-called experts, we wrote how we should manage hypotension with vasopressors during cesarean section. And our goal was that we should keep the blood pressure within 10% of baseline values. So anything below 90% of baseline value needs immediate treatment. Anything below 80% is we would consider that as very severe and serious hypotension, and you would need immediate action. The mechanism is arteriolar vasodilation. It's not reduced venous return. So you will not be able to solve the problem by giving fluid. Fluid alone will never completely avoid hypotension. You need to work on the arteriolar and arterial tone of the patient. So you need to give vasoconstriction, basically. It's the decrease in systemic vascular resistance, small artery vasodilation, together with a little bit of venodilation, and of course the aortocaval compression. This is the reason why we have seen in the last 20 years in research that if you give fluids to these patients, this will not work. You need to do something else. And I would encourage you to read these three articles if you want to understand the mechanism of spinal-induced hypotension of spinal anesthesia in cesarean section patients. I think Robert Dyer is the person who knows most about this, and he has written several excellent articles on the problem explaining the mechanism, and they have been summarized in our international consensus statement, to which actually he also participated. Apart from the fact that we measure blood pressure, we also monitor heart rate. It's very simple to do in cesarean section patients. And heart rate, for me, is a surrogate marker for cardiac output. Whenever the heart rate is good, cardiac output will be good, even if there is hypotension or hypertension. If heart rate goes down, most likely cardiac output is going down, and you also need to treat this. Hypotension has significant consequences for both mother and baby, and inadequate treatment also has significant complications. If you give too many fluids, a pregnant patient might end up in pulmonary edema, especially preeclamptic patients. If you give over-treatment by vasopressors or the wrong vasopressors, you might end up with hypertension, which causes problems as well. And if you have hypotension, your baby might actually be acidotic when it's born. And I just want to give you a very clinical example. This is a normal pregnant patient, no medical history whatsoever, and she gets a spinal with 12 milligrams of hyperbaric bupivacaine, which I guess is probably a dose you would be using here in routine practice as well. Her blood pressure goes down after about 5 minutes, and she receives ephedrine. Okay, fine. I wouldn't do that, but fine. It's standard common treatment worldwide. Her blood pressure goes down or remains not the same. Why? Because the ephedrine hasn't kicked in yet. It takes a couple of minutes. And then she becomes bradycardic because the block is now reaching her cardioaccelerator fibers. Her cardiac output is dropping. And the reaction of the anesthesiologist at that time is to give atropine and ephedrine. Now, by that time, all these drugs then, 1 or 2 minutes later, start to kick in, and she becomes significantly hypertensive and tachycardic. You would say, okay, her hypotension is gone, all fine. But no, because then suddenly she goes into left ventricular failure all within 5 minutes after the start of the spinal anesthetic. The baby isn't born yet, the cesarean hasn't started yet. She goes in acute left ventricular failure, she goes in pulmonary edema, and she turns out to have a myocardial infarction as a result of a coronary artery dissection, as a result of the hypertension and the tachycardia. All due to inadequate or inappropriate treatment of the hypotension. Now you think this is an exceptional case. Well, this is a case published in Anesthesia, one of the top journals, and if you go and look in the literature, you will find several dozen of these cases. So it's not that rare. This is the babies. The risk of fetal acidemia. And as you can see, with the spinal, where you see more hypotension, and also you might give more ephedrine in this historical study, there is more fetal acidosis. And there is a higher incidence of hypotension, of low umbilical artery pH values, below 7, in 2% of the babies. This means that in 2% of babies born as a result of your spinal, you might end up with permanent neurologic damage, because 50% of babies born with an umbilical artery pH below 7 have permanent neurologic damage. So it is important to avoid those low pH values. How can we do that? Well, the techniques to prevent spinal-induced hypotension are various. You can work on the venous system, and I told you it will not work that well. You can give fluids, left lateral tilt. You could give vasopressors working on the arterial system, or you could lower your spinal dose. Let's look first at fluids. I'm pretty sure most of you will be giving a crystalloid in clinical practice. If you give a crystalloid to prevent hypotension, just a crystalloid, a preloading, I'm sorry, but that doesn't work. Actually, it increases the risk of hypotension. It has been shown that as a result of the release of atrial factor, you will have more hypotension if you give a fluid bolus before your spinal. Colloids are better, but I realize there are problems with colloids. They might cause allergic reactions, and they are more expensive. And perhaps not readily available in every part of the world. But crystalloids, given as a fluid bolus preloading, have no positive effect on hypotension, and actually should be banned. What you should do is you should be giving a, and this is just a summary of all the literature, where you can see that colloids on the right-hand side are above the line, all the studies with colloids, so that it means it's better, crystalloids don't do a thing. What you should be doing, and this is another example, that colloids are actually better than crystalloids, significantly less hypotension. But if you do have to use crystalloids because colloids are not available, too expensive, you're worried about allergic reactions, you should be giving a colloid. So you should actually give your crystalloid together with your spinal while you're performing your spinal anesthetic. And if you then give a bolus of fluid, crystalloids, you will be able to slightly reduce the incidence of hypotension. It will not abolish it, but it will help a little bit. Why are they ineffective? I already mentioned it. Crystalloids have a short half-life. There is, because of the fluid bolus, an increase in the left atrial pressures. There will be a release of atrial natriuretic factor, as a result, you will increase diuresis, you will have smooth muscle relaxation, and you will have more hypotension after 1 or 2 minutes, but not while you're giving it. Left lateral tilt is certainly a positive thing to do, but it also is not completely effective in preventing hypotension and will not improve neonatal outcome. So the conclusion about fluids is, if you give something, it's probably best a colloid, but I realize it's not available for everybody. If you give a crystalloid, you should give it as a colloid, not a preload. But even if you give a colloid, even if you give a colloid, they will be insufficient. They will not completely abolish hypotension. You could lower the spinal dose. That's what I do. I use 7.5, 8 milligrams of heavy bupivacaine together with a lipophilic opioid like fentanyl or sufentanil in my routine clinical practice, and then you will see less hypotension. Is it completely gone? No, but the incidence and the severity will be reduced. So it works. It will also cause less nausea and vomiting. However, there is a risk if you reduce the dose, especially when you work with single-shot spinal anesthesia, and I gather most of you will be using single-shot spinals, that there are some patients that will have breakthrough pain, especially at the end of surgery, and especially if surgery is a little bit prolonged. This, I would guess, in about 5 to 10%. So you need to either stick with your higher dose or use a CSE, a combined spinal epidural, have a rescue epidural catheter. But I realize this is another technique, it adds cost, it's another skills that you need to acquire. But that's what we do in our hospital. But whatever you do, fluids, low dose, you still will need something to manage hypotension and to prevent it. So you still need vasopressors. This is why we wrote in 2017-18 this international consensus guideline on the different vasopressors. It has become extremely clear over the last 20 years mainly by the work of Warwick Nagankey from Hong Kong that phenylephrine is undoubtedly the vasopressor of choice for cesarean section patients. There are numerous well-designed randomized controlled trials comparing ephedrine and phenylephrine, all giving you the burden of proof that phenylephrine is superior to ephedrine. It works quicker, it can be easily titrated, and it gives you far better fetal outcomes because there will be less fetal acidosis with phenylephrine. This is an excellent editorial that was published in 2009 by Richard Smiley from New York, looking at the evidence at that time. And since then, there is much more evidence. Because anesthesiologists in the United States and in Western Europe, despite the overwhelming evidence that phenylephrine was better, were not that easy to be convinced. They were hesitant to go away from their ephedrine, which they were using for 20, 30 years, to phenylephrine. And he said, and I think I can just read out this, the consistent, high quality, and productive clinical investigations of Nagankey and colleagues, the evidence is now sufficient for a change in attitude and practice to be strongly encouraged. The weight of the evidence has now equaled the burden of proof, and our clinical burden should be to incorporate the evidence into our routine practice. Why? Well, the most important reason is because you can easily manage hypotension with phenylephrine, but what is more importantly, the baby benefits. All studies, there is no opposite study showing the opposite. All studies show better umbilical artery pH values, better base excess in the babies born when mothers receive phenylephrine compared to mothers that have received ephedrine. Why? Well, because ephedrine goes transplacentally, will have a beta sympathomimetic, beta stimulant effect on the neonate and on the fetus, and will result in acidosis because of oxygen consumption in that baby. Phenylephrine does not go transplacentally and will not have that positive effect. The evidence is overwhelming and every review article shows exactly the same. Now you might say, is it clinically relevant, that difference in base excess in pH? Well, it's not for many babies. The healthy babies, the babies that are born from healthy women in elective cesarean sections, it's a minority that will benefit, not all. If you have a pH of 7.24 or 7.27, that's not important. But then occasionally, you will have a baby that goes to 7.01, 7.02, occasionally, and you might have had a better pH with phenylephrine 7.1 in this baby, and this might have avoided permanent neurologic damage. And I give you the overwhelming evidence. What is the best way to give it? As a continuous infusion. Now, you might think, oh, I need a syringe driver, I need a pump, but I will come to that later on. But the best way to prevent hypotension in pregnant patients is by giving it as an infusion. This is a nice study from the United States, from the group of Ashraf Habib, looking at phenylephrine, nothing, and then four groups, 25, 50, 75, or 100 micrograms per minute. And the additionally looked at the number of physician treatments and the number of hypotensive episodes and bradycardia. And what they noticed was if you do not give phenylephrine, you will have huge percent of hypotension, 80%. If you do give high doses of phenylephrine, you will have hypertension in a lot of patients as well. And you would like to avoid that. What you need to do, and you will have bradycardia, which is a problem. So the ideal infusion rate is 25 to 50 micrograms per minute, looking at about a hypotension reduced from 80% to about 20%, and with virtually no bradycardia occurring. So a positive effect. And this, a similar study was done by Warwick Naganki, where we combined phenylephrine with ephedrine in different ratios. You had 100% phenylephrine in one group, and group 5 was 100% ephedrine, and then a mixture of both in group 2, 3, and 4. And what they noticed was that in the group with phenylephrine, pure phenylephrine, you had better pH, 7.29, while it was only 7.21 in the group with pure ephedrine, and the lowest pH values, the ED was 7.12. So a risky area there. And this is for non-elective cesarean sections, the difference wasn't that big as you saw in elective cesarean sections. So our international consensus guidelines stated that you need to give left uterine displacement, you need to give an intravenous colloid with crystalloids or a preload with colloids, you should keep the blood pressure at 90% of baseline values, and you should be doing this with an infusion of phenylephrine and treat hypotensive episodes with boluses of phenylephrine. So this is what the consensus statement would say. And I come to the practical aspects later on into the talk. This is just other examples and compares it with noradrenaline. So practical approach. How I do it, how I would suggest you do it. Well, first of all, I would take a blood pressure reading and take a standard baseline measurement. Three blood pressures in the morning of the cesarean or just before the cesarean, and this is your baseline. And then I would keep the blood pressure within approximately 90% of baseline. And you could give then a colloid, crystalloid, you give your spinal, and if the blood pressure stays within 90-95% of baseline, you don't need to do anything. If it goes below 95%, you should give a bolus of phenylephrine. If there is bradycardia, you could add some ephedrine. If it goes really very low, you should give a phenylephrine bolus. This is if you just give boluses. I would add a additional thing. I would give an infusion of phenylephrine, either with a syringe driver, but I realize not everybody has that. I don't have it either in my operating theater for cesarean sections. So what I do is I just add my phenylephrine to my colloid or to my crystalloid bag, to my 500 milliliters or my liter of crystalloid. And then I manage it. You have to monitor blood pressure on regular occasions, every minute. You should keep it within those 90%, and you should also monitor your heart rate and avoid bradycardia by giving ephedrine boluses if there is bradycardia. So very practical. This is a cesarean at 8:40 in the morning, our second case of the day. I add some phenylephrine in my institution. It's a colloid, but it could be a crystalloid. I add 500 micrograms into the bag, and I look at the blood pressure, which in this patient prior to surgery was 134/69. We then perform in my hospital the CSE, the combined spinal epidural, but you could do a single shot spinal. You see a little bit of drop of the blood pressure, although there is some phenylephrine going in. I would then add a bolus of 50 or 100 micrograms of phenylephrine, and then you try to restore the blood pressure within 90% of baseline values as quickly as possible. And might I also immediately point out to you that despite the 500 micrograms in the crystalloid and despite the bolus of phenylephrine, there is no bradycardia. The heart rate is around 80 and is quite stable around 80. So I would be giving my phenylephrine as an infusion, but not with a syringe driver. I would just add it to my bag of crystalloid or colloid. And this is what I would be doing if I would be having a syringe driver. I would be starting my 50 ml syringe at a rate of about 25 to 50 micrograms. And whenever there is hypotension, I would give boluses. And whenever there is bradycardia, I would add 5 or 10 milligrams of ephedrine. But what I do in clinical life, in my institution, I add my phenylephrine, usually 500 micrograms in a bag of 500 milliliters, so it's 1 microgram per milliliter, and then I let it run while I'm performing the spinal, and then I give boluses. So the take-home message is hypotension in cesarean sections patients, and in all patients basically, should be avoided. Keep it within 10% of baseline. Use a crystalloid, but use it as a colloid. Also, give vasopressors while you're performing your spinal in the prevention of hypotension, and give it as an infusion. And if there is bradycardia, which is sometimes in a small proportion of patients a problem, you should be giving ephedrine in boluses to treat maternal bradycardia. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Van de Velde, for a very nice presentation. Are there any questions from the floor? Please.
First of all, I would like to thank you very much for such a great talk today. I have one question for you. For the crystalloid colloid, how much would you recommend to give for the patient before we conduct the spinal anesthesia in healthy patient?
So the colloid? The colloid,
yes.
Colloid. So if I would be giving, because I in my practice I'm using a colloid, and then I'm using 500 milliliters of an hydroxyethyl starch solution. But if I would be using a crystalloid, I would be giving 1 liter of Ringer's lactate or plasmalite. And I would be giving this, I would open my infusion fully when I'm starting with my spinal or my combined spinal. So this bag of 1 liter will be going into the patient while I'm performing the spinal, while they're preparing for the cesarean, and usually by the time the baby is out, the bag of a liter will be in the patient. That's what I would be advising when I'm using a crystalloid. So I would be using 500 milliliters of a colloid instead of a liter when I'm using a colloid.
So 500?
Yes.
During the spinal?
While you're performing the spinal and installing the patient for the incision and the cesarean. So in those, you start your spinal and about 15 minutes later the baby will be born, probably. That's the time, 10-15 minutes. And in that time, this fluid will be running into the patient.
Okay, thank you.
I'm Kasana from Siriraj Hospital. Thank you for coming, traveling across the globe to give us a wonderful lecture. I've enjoyed it a lot. I have two questions. First, do we need to keep the quite a narrow margin of safe, like 95% from baseline of blood pressure? Is there any difference in outcome? And the second one is, if you are giving a spinal in previously hypertensive patient, like severe preeclampsia, do you still use phenylephrine as your preference?
Yeah. So, I'm indeed, and I think our international consensus statement was very strict. We need to keep that blood pressure within that 90-95% margin. Why? Well, if blood pressure goes lower, there is that effect on the mother and on the baby. The mother will start feeling nauseous, vomiting sometimes. And if the surgery is not very quick, for whatever reason, repeat cesarean section, inexperienced surgeon, it might last for a couple of minutes that this baby has reduced uteroplacental perfusion. And at that time, these babies might do badly. This is rare, but one is one too many. So we prefer to keep it really, really tight. And it has shown that this improves the outcomes. Okay? On your second question, what about the preeclamptic patient, the hypertensive patient? I think here, first of all, preeclampsia and spinal anesthesia, you will see less hypotension. So preeclamptic patients are protected against hypotensive episodes. Has been clearly shown by Vicky Clark 10 or 15 years ago. However, I would still be trying to prevent it by giving a reduced phenylephrine infusion. So what I do in preeclamptic patients is instead of giving 500 micrograms to my bag, I would half the amount of phenylephrine that I do in my bag, and I virtually never have to give another bolus. So I would reduce the amount of phenylephrine, but I would not omit it. I would still be giving it. Now, there are situations where the blood pressure is 220 before you start your cesarean, really severe preeclampsia, and then, of course, the situation is different. But the majority of preeclamptic patients is a blood pressure of 150, 160, and then I would halve the amount of phenylephrine.
Thank you.
Hello, I am Titi Pansodisopa from Lusin Hospital. So I have one question. Is there any previous studies comparing between norepinephrine and phenylephrine for the C-section?
Well, there is at the moment, as far as I know, there is two studies that looked at norepinephrine and phenylephrine. And they both come again from Warwick Nagantki, as far as I can tell. There might be some coming up in the near future on this. Norepinephrine is certainly a valuable alternative, but here you can't. It's really difficult to work with boluses of noradrenaline, I think. So you probably really need to work with a very fine-tuned continuous infusion. The advantage is that you have similar hemodynamic profile, but there is a slightly higher cardiac output and slightly less bradycardia. But much more work needs to be done on that, and I think it's future research. So it's a nice topic to do.
And the last question from Ajahn Keshada, please.
Thank you very much. It's a very concise lecture in the short period. I'd like to know that about your practice that add phenylephrine in the fluid, 500 cc. So if the problem is bradycardia and hypotension, so will you stop the maintenance of phenylephrine intravenously and add ephedrine, because I cannot see from your algorithm?
Yeah, what I would do if I have so if you, I've added my 500 micrograms of, and you see the blood pressure remains stable or goes up, hypertension, and there might be some bradycardia, what I would then do is first give my 5 milligrams of ephedrine, let it go in, and then reduce the rate in with which my bag goes into the patient. I would just reduce it significantly. And every time if I need to give a drug, I just open it and reduce it again. But I have to say, in my real-life clinical practice, I virtually hardly ever see hypertension with this system occurring. It's very rare. Bradycardia occasionally, but if it's bradycardia without hypertension, I would just add my ephedrine and keep the phenylephrine infusion going. If it's hypertension and bradycardia, then I reduce the rate.
So let's say that you still have ephedrine for rescue.
It's rescue for bradycardia. It's not rescue for hypotension. If it's hypotension without bradycardia, it's phenylephrine bolus. I think I only have to use ephedrine in 1-3% of my patients. In 97%, I don't see bradycardia. And I only worry about, because under, you have to have this this diagram, this flow chart. It says 60 beats per minute. This is international consensus. I go lower. I don't worry about 52, as long as the patient is having a good blood pressure or and is in sinus rhythm. But of course, international consensus, we agreed on 60. But I very rarely see heart rates below 60. It's extremely rare with this system.
Because bradycardia can occur by many factors, like high level of analgesia.
It's a combination of the spinal that is high up, together with the reactive bradycardia due to the phenylephrine. Both mechanisms work together in this situation, so it can happen. But a pregnant patient is protected against bradycardia because of the changes in normal changes in pregnancy. There is a positive chronotropic effect of pregnancy. So it's for me, it's something you need to be careful with, but I think it's easily manageable by just giving a small bolus of ephedrine.
Thank you.
And by the way, if there are any questions from you, I think there will be a break in half an hour or something like that, and I will be at the stand to answer any questions you want to ask me.
Thank you, Professor, and thank you everyone for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.